Greetings, commanders, and welcome to episode 284 of Lave Radio, the show that talks about the mirror universe of Elite Dangerous and the fantastic community that surrounds it. I'm your host, Commander Souverain, and joining me in the orange fleet carrier for this episode are... we have our... Who have we got? Our Director of All Beings, Commander Shan.
Hello.
We have our... Vice President of Health and Safety, Commander Edelweiss, or Ben Moss Woodward.
Ole!
We have our, he was our tech monkey, or he would be our tech monkey in a parallel universe, but here he is obviously our Director of Infrastructure, Commander Ventura.
Hello.
And I am now a professional trade attaché. So, if you wish, you can join us live. We're hanging out in game. It's sort of past the orange space dredger towards the planet Lave, and the fleet carrier is just in orbit around the planet there. If you can't get to us in game, you can join our Twitch chat channel, which you can access through laveradio.com/live and clicking on live chat, and also at twitch.tv/laveradio.
I think later on we're heading towards Stroud Base Alpha on Lave 2, aren't we, Sue?
Yeah, that's true. I think it'll be daytime a bit later. So the sunrise always looks pretty spectacular over the bay there. With all the trees and the little animals running around. So, yeah, good idea. We can head there later. Cool. Okay, so what's everybody been up to? Shan, what have you been up to this week?
Well, I had a great time actually trying out new flight suits in the Lave Station clothing emporium. But then I had an alarm come off and that let me know my ship was attentively boarded. So I then had to run through the corridors of Lave Station to repel the boarders who were trying to steal my ship. So yeah, I had a good bit of fun there.
Nice. That does sound good. Commander Edelweiss, what have you been up to?
Well, I've mostly actually been trying to get parts from the Tin Isla graveyard by doing EVAs. And just essentially, I've been going off through all the old ships, trying to find the extended engineered components and trying to retrofit them into my ships.
Ah, oh, brilliant! That sounds super good fun. It's really nice that we have the functionality to do this sort of thing. I have been. What have I been doing? I've been. I've had a fairly sedentary week, actually. I've just been visiting. I've been visiting volcanic worlds throughout the bubble, landing in my Panther Clipper, and then just getting out and doing some spelunking. So I've been exploring some cave systems using my handheld mining laser to mine some valuable materials, climbing back in and flying off and selling it all, really. So dodging pirates and repelling boarders and that sort of thing. So it's been a really good week, actually. It's been super fun. We have a couple of special guests with us this evening, some non-regular panelists who I ought to introduce. So there is, we have the lovely and glamorous Commander Mac Winston, who is now nearly become regular. Mac, how the hell are you?
I'm phenomenal.
Excellent. And what have you been doing this week?
Well, it's been quite an interesting week. I finally got enough arcs to buy the Denton Patrius outfit, and I look so sexy in it. Other than that, and of course that's, you know, going to the Lave Station bar, you know, hanging out and looking imperial and regal and all that. Other than that, I've been reading actually a really good book. It's called Ignition by a guy called John D. Clark, who was a propellant engineer. He wrote this book in the late 1970s, and it's like the history of rocketry, and it's written in a great style, and it's absolutely fascinating and hair-raising at times. But yeah, it's a great book. I really recommend it. You can get it on Amazon for your Kindle or whatever.
And what's it called? The History of Rocketry?
No, it's just called Ignition. Is its main target. It's by its main title. I think there's a subtitle in there as well. It was out of print for years, but yeah, you can buy it in paperback now as well. But it's by a guy called John D. Clark, who was one of the scientists heavily involved in developing rocket propellants from an oxidizers, propellants, and there's lots of explosions in it. It's really good.
Cool. Okay. Excellent. That sounds right up our alley. Actually, I'll look that up. We also have a longtime friend of the show, Commander Atris 5060. How the hell are you?
Oh, I'm doing very well. Having a nice time this week so far. Though I may have become persona non grata again with the Empire. I did accidentally crash my Panther Clipper, taking out part of Baker Terminal into the station there. So yeah, I'm kind of wanted in Empire space for the most part, and can't go anywhere near it. The only benefit, yeah, though, is I now have a crew of rogue criminals on my Panther Clipper that were just flying around the galaxy looking for a place to dock and refuel finally.
Well, I suppose the upside of that is that due to the meaningful choice system in the game, that you should now have a little bit better reputation with the Federation and be able to engage with all the game systems via the federal starports and stuff.
Oh, absolutely. Well, it's not only the Federation. My standing with the Alliance finally improved, so I actually can show up near their space again.
Ah, brilliant. And presumably you can start ranking up with those guys, you know, climbing the Alliance Navy ranks.
Oh, yeah. And I really, really cannot wait to unlock the Alliance exploration ship. What was the name of it again? What was it? The Turner?
Yes, that was it. Yes, the Turner. Yes. Can't remember the snake name, but yes, absolutely. Jolly good. All right, well, that's our
very quickly CD. For a second, apparently Ignition is also available in Audible, so if you like reading your words, no, listening to your words, you can get on Audible now as well.
Cool. All right, there you go. If you like rockets and have ears, then Ben Mosswood has the tip for you. Okay, let's talk about development news. What have the devs said this week? Well, first things first, Frontier are on track for their detailed 2020 roadmap. It's been really nice to see, actually, every single year since 2015 or even release, the roadmaps have just been, they've been so thorough, they've been so detailed, and they've just absolutely nailed every milestone. And it's really cool to see that 2020 is no different. So we're on target to continue the rapid frequency, high quality content updates that we've had since the Horizons release in 2015.
Yeah, I was really glad I brought a lifetime pass at Horizons.
Oh God, yeah, the best money I ever spent was that LEP.
Exactly.
Shan, do you want to tell us about the open beta that we're looking forward to? That, yes, starts next week?
Yeah, there's a couple of things that's going to be in the open beta. There's the much promised big game hunting on Earthlights. Now, Earthlights have been around for a while, but now they've finally managed to populate Earthlights with creatures, really, I suppose you could call them, that you can either photograph or shoot with your hand pulse laser, really. So I'm looking forward to that. And unlike with No Man's Sky, the procedural generation has been top notch, and the screenshots have been showing us on a weekly basis. So I'm really looking forward to that open beta. The other thing I'm looking forward to, and I think we'll come on to this later, is they're going to be introducing intra-system jump gates, you know, so where you can arrive in a system, you take the jump gate, and it takes you right the way across the system without any of that waiting around in supercruise. So I'm wanting those to happen.
That's being rolled out with the big game hunting beta, isn't it?
It is, yeah. Which means if someone finds an interesting creature on an Earth-like next to a distant star in the system, you can just go straight to it without having to worry about flying to it. So, yeah, look forward to that.
That is really exciting. I must say that, I mean, the newsletter has always been a pretty weighty read. And in recent years, it's just got bigger and more detailed with more snippets of behind the curtains of what's going on at FDev. And the last few weeks, with all the concept art, all the screenshots, all the detailed sort of snippets of info that we've had about procedurally generated life on atmospheric worlds has been awesome to see. I've really, really enjoyed those.
Well, that goes hand in hand with the DDF used to be expanded as well, isn't it? That's the other thing they talked about, expanding the DDF or open to all players, not just ones who managed to get in the Kickstarter.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. They have done that. Yeah, so that's quite exciting. Sorry, Ben, you wanted to leap in about big game hunting.
Yeah, I was just thinking that, as you said, looking at those screenshots, I can't believe that they've got the Darwin system looking... It's like generating everything from the realistic physics of the planet and then evolving essentially what life form would actually work there. I think that the work, it looks so realistic. It's amazing.
Yeah, it is really, really impressive. And it looks, it's all from first
principles. Yeah, as you say, it's all from first principles.
Very cool. Atrus?
Yeah, did you guys happen to capture that screenshot where it looked like you were hanging off the back platform from the back of the Cobra Mark III with the sniper rifle to take down that big dinosaur?
Oh, yes.
It's so completely good. Awesome.
Yeah, it took me right back to the Kickstarter. Very, very cool. Can't
David
wait to
has
that.
Been on about that for years, hasn't he?
He has. He can't stop banging on about hunting big dinosaurs, can he?
He has been on the screen quite a lot recently. You know, you can tell he's really excited about the game because you almost can't keep him off, really.
That's true. I mean, it's the same every big update, though. Every year, every update, you know, David and the senior devs are keen to get out into the community and discuss what they've got planned. So I guess it's no different from usual in that regard. Mac?
Yeah, I think probably one of their best moves in the last 18 months was poaching from Microsoft, the developers of Flight Simulator, because I'm a bit of a snob when it comes to atmospheric flight models, and they've really done such a good job taking into account things like pressure, density, weather effects, all that kind of stuff. And each planet really does feel unique when you fly through the atmosphere. And it had to cost them a pretty penny to get those developers, of course, because I mean they're having to compete against Microsoft in their pay. And we all know how much they pay. But yeah, it was. I think that was it was a bold move, but I mean, forget all the big game hunting. I mean, meh. Just the detail in the clouds and the atmospheres of all the various planets, and how are they realistically? I mean, you fly through a thunderstorm in your in your large ship, you know, whatever, you know, like my favorite cutter, and you can really feel the turbulence bouncing you around and hear the hail sort of hammering on the windscreen and all that kind of stuff. It's absolutely brilliant. I mean, it's like a whole game's worth of content, just the atmospheres alone.
Yeah, absolutely. And they, you know, the flight model is always such a huge part of the game. And it's so nice to see them carry that realism through. So on the Twitch chat, Prime Bitstorm says, he asks, have we tried the Moray Starboat yet on one of the water worlds? I haven't actually tried the Moray Starboat on a water world. Have any of you guys?
Well, that is part of our main discussion. And for a sneak preview of that, we're asking the question, is the Moray Starboat worth it for underwater exploration, or are you better off scuba diving in your aquatic remlock? So we'll be talking about that a bit later anyway. So yeah, don't worry about the Moray, we're definitely talking about that issue coming up.
And the last thing in development news about this week is the latest cosmetic to be added to the store, which is earnable in game, is we're going to get space cats added to the roster of cosmetic pets that you can add to the so that you can add to your ship and your base on planets. So lots of fun stuff there. Anyway, let's move on to in-game events. What's been happening this week? I guess the biggest thing from us, like this is quite a personal bit of news, and so we'll lead with it because it's big news for us. Is that the power Lave Radio has actually risen up to number 2 in the power play rankings overall, which we are super, super excited about. And I just want to say on behalf of the show, thank you to all of you commanders out there who have pledged and engaged in loads of really fun and rewarding and varied power play activity to boost your chosen power, which didn't involve sabotage at all. It's been super, super fun flying with you all.
Especially since it's open only now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's cool to see everybody coming out of solo and private groups and stuff and getting stuck in.
I mean, they rebalanced the Crime and Punishment, 2 releases ago? It's been phenomenal since it actually do power play. And I, for one, as a loyal supporter of Dr. Stroud, our fearless leader of LRN, I was glad to say that we made it up to number 2 and have been part of the initiative.
Yeah, it's been very good to have you. Ben?
I actually just want to take this opportunity to thank Atrus for getting Lave Radio Network from being a minor power into the power play. I think, we couldn't have done it without you, to be honest. So I think it's you have put in so much time and effort. I really want to, from the bottom of me, the soles of my feet, I want to thank you for all the effort you put in there, mate.
The only way that was really made possible, in all honesty, was the fact that they took away so many of the repetitive clicks you have to go through to purchase the materials you need to trade to actually fortify different systems. It has made life so much easier.
I might have to try power play again.
Oh, it's totally worth it. A completely revamped system now.
It's been really nice to see how much work that Frontier have put into power play over the years. It's really cool that they put a feature in. They listen, and they've demonstrated it over and over again. They've demonstrated it with CQC, power play, multi-crew. They put a feature in, make sure it's feature complete, listen carefully to feedback from players, tweak it, iterate upon it, have several bites at the cherry until it's absolutely spot on. It's really nice to see the amount of development that's gone into power play over the years.
Oh, don't even forget the fact that we queuing for CQC now is such a breeze. You just sign up within your ship, and then as soon as a match becomes available, you're just popped right in.
Yeah, so that is really cool. The lobby system is really good now.
That's if the system doesn't say, "Hey, you look like you want to play CQC. Well, we've got a match here for you. Come and get it."
Yeah, we're getting slightly off topic. We've got the
like that never happens.
We've got our detailed CQC episode where we discuss the new lobby system and the excellent new matchmaking system later on this year. Galnet Online, there's been a bit of controversy in the community over Galnet. And the question I want to pose to you guys is it too much? Is the flow of news and information in the game just a bit too much? I've seen it on the forum, I've seen it on Twitter. Some people are saying, I love the stories, they're great, and I can just stick them on kind of audio or stick them on my little screen in the cockpit and just let it play. And other people are saying, look, there's just too much lore, there's too much backstory, too much context to all of our actions. I just can't absorb it. Shan, what are your thoughts?
I think it's actually got a lot better, because when it first came out, when you had the Galnet audio and it read it, it sounded very robotic and almost like those spam YouTube videos where they just have an automated voice. But it really sounds as though they've gone the extra mile to recruit proper voice actors to read it out. And yeah, I mean, for me, when I'm out exploring and playing, it's now replaced Netflix on my second screen, because you can just listen to it and get involved in the universe of Elite and sort of really feel as though you're there. So I can see how people who may be short for time might feel there's too much content, but it's available anytime you want, so you don't have to listen to it live.
Yeah, that's true. I suppose if you're a very casual player, the feeling that the galaxy has moved on without you might be a little bit off-putting, but for veterans, I really like it.
Yeah, Two Flags have just said in chat, they do seem to put a lot of commercials and advertising in the Galnet audio now. I don't know if you heard the ones where they advertise ship skins as adverts inside Galnet.
What? Sort of out of universe? Immersion breaking, you mean?
No, no. You know how, like, we've had lay radio adverts forever?
Yeah.
Frontier have adopted that now, haven't they, to put in the...
Yeah. The lore advert. Yeah, they're very cool. Very, very. I really like the colour that they bring to the universe. Very, very good.
That's right.
And we've also, what else has been going on? We had our first, Buckyball triathlon, which was it swimming, running, and racing in the SRV? Is that right, or was it on a hover bike? I can't remember. Ben, can you tell us about this?
I have to admit, I actually ignored all that stuff. I just, you know what I'm like on anything planet side, you know, unless I'm on my hover bike. You know, I've wanted a speeder bike ever since Alpha. I'm glad we got it, you know, a couple of years ago. I love it, but the rest of it, I just can't be bothered with, to be honest.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. Shannon, well, did you
Alex, watch it? I did, actually. I mean, Alex Turner has made a racetrack on the Sea of Tranquility. And so it's a combined foot and the racing variant of the SRV. Around his track on the moon, basically, and it looked really fun. Particularly now, you can engineer racing SRVs to improve the handling or make them faster and more skittish. So that has added a complete variation to the SRVs. And I did hear a rumor actually that as part of one of the updates coming later in the year, you were going to be, have a robotic pit crew that would jump out and change the tires and you're racing SRV.
Brilliant. Perfect. Yeah, so the hop onto the Buckyball website if you're interested in taking part in the next Buckyball triathlon. I think the next one will definitely involve swimming on an Earth-like atmospheric world. But this one was just a foot and so just running on foot and SRV racing on the surface of the moon. So we also had a little bit of controversy elsewhere. So I was talking about to Atris earlier about ranking up with the Alliance. Did you guys see the people on the forum whining that when they rank up with the Federation, the Empire, or the Alliance, it impacts their experience with the other superpowers? So saying, like, you know, they put a load of effort into ranking up with the Federation and becoming really friendly with them, and then that impacts their experience of the galaxy elsewhere, and the Empire, for example, are less friendly to them when they go into their space. Did you see that?
I did, yes. I was a little bit worried because they wrote an open letter and Frontier tend to take notice of open letters and implement what's in them. So, kind of a bit worried about.
Yeah, that's true.
To be honest, I think it serves them right. I mean, you know, I love the fact that people are losing their cutters because they're trying to go and get the Corvette. Of course it's going to happen. What do you expect?
Yeah, that's definitely
serves them right for being turncoats. I mean, everybody should just accept that the Empire is the best and... If you want to hang on to your cutter, you've got to be loyal. I mean,
listen, fair is fair. Dirty imp. It's independence all the way.
Yeah, the okay, so I get where they're coming from, but I just want to pose this question. Imagine if that wasn't a feature. Imagine if you could just rank up really, like, you could rank up to Vice Admiral with the Federation, and also up to King with the Empire at the same time, with no impact on either reputation. Like, that would feel a bit more flimsy. Like, that would feel...
It'd feel very gamey, wouldn't it?
It would, yeah. It would. Well, that's my take on it, anyway.
Oh, I can't remember. What was it, 2 years ago with that beta that they did with us? They did exactly that, and people were complaining that, you know, in the galactic war between the Federation and the Empire, didn't really have any consequences from it. So Frontier took that on board and said, right, we're not going to do that. So it's been tried. We know it doesn't work. So kind of glad we moved past that point.
Yeah, exactly. I agree with you. It does feel like a conversation that's already put to bed. Yeah, totally. Right. So we elsewhere, we also had, I think this was on Monday, we had players gathering at the Tianisla Orbital Graveyard.
Yours, wasn't it, Ben? Is this yours?
Yeah, this is mine. I'm basically wanting to promote some of Commander Thane's work because he's gone off and done the audio drama version of The Dark Wheel, and is being played in game in the Tinaila graveyard. And it was as I said earlier, I was sort of hanging out there earlier, like through the week, and hearing it over the headphones, it's just the sense of immersion while the story's being read out to you. It takes my breath away, and you know, Thane has done, as ever, a great job there.
Well, the commanders he got to actually do the synchronized spacewalk. Ah, fantastic. He really pulled out all the stops on this one.
Yeah.
That was very cool. I'll tell you what, EVAing around the graveyard is really, they've done a really good job with
that. They've nailed it.
Were you there a few weeks ago where, I've forgotten the player's name now, but basically they replicated the scene in The Dark Wheel where Alex boards the Cobra, you know, that he then flies off at. So they mimic the whole scene as if it was from the Dark Wheel novel, and I thought that was awesome.
I was actually, because it was done over the weekend, I was at home with the family over that, unfortunately.
All right.
Yeah, they use the hatch breaking multi tool, the hand tool thing.
That's right. Yeah,
very cool. I tell you, I must admit that Orbital Graveyard is it's one of the most atmospheric places in the game, really. People always say, like, oh, you know, don't make such a big deal out of it. It's super easy to add. All they did with that was add some wreckage as a POI. But like, I feel like that misses the point. Like, it may have been really a really simple and easy thing that Frontier could add, but at the same time, it's so atmospheric. It lends such a lot of it's such a nod to the history of the franchise. It lends such a lot of atmosphere. I just think it's really cool. If you haven't been, you've got to visit it. The Tinaila Orbital Graveyard is one of the must visit places in the game for me. Anyway, let's talk about the newsletter.
By the way, Sue, have you seen it in VR yet?
Yes. Yeah. Awesome. Very awesome in VR. Just all those ships just spinning gently around you. Fantastic.
And it's persistent as well, isn't it? Because if you nudge a wreck, well, you get a bounty anyway, obviously. But you can, if you nudge a wreck and it drifts slightly off course, the next time so you come in or a player comes in, it will be in that same position.
Yeah. Very cool. Right. Okay. So newsletter, what has been in the newsletter? Tell you what, these newsletter segments, I feel like they're taking up the show, you know, like when we first started, the newsletter was like 10 or 15 minutes and we just whittled through what the dev news was. And it's just like, I just feel like we spend so much time on it. It's so full of stuff. So, okay, let's whittle through it. Panther ship clip. That Panther ship kit, nearly. Who's bought this?
I have. Go on, Jan.
No, I have. I mean, it was quite a way through. I think it was on page 45 of the newsletter. So they maintaining the tradition of not really promoting the ship skins and stuff like that. They sort of put them at the back, almost like the adverts in the old comics. But yeah, so I quite enjoyed it, actually. What did you think?
Well, I never really got that far. The trouble is, it's too damn long to read. I never get through it anymore. So I usually learn from these things from the podcast, and I end up fiddling with them like days later. So I've just had to make do with the they didn't really make much fanfare about it, but there's been some new paint jobs and ship kits for the some of the other ships, like the Cutter, of course. So and they should really be. And everybody's like mad on the Panther Clipper. I don't know why. It's a box. It's a box with engines on it, and well, some of these, I think it's overshadowing a lot of the other really good stuff that's been coming out. Some of the interesting, some of the more interesting ship kits on some of the ships that are just getting overlooked, because you know everybody's a billionaire. They've got their Panther Clippers, and they're all sort of gadding around the universe in these hideous boxes. And I think it's doing a little bit of an injustice, really. But anyway, I could rant all night about this, so I I think Atrus wants to say something, so I'll pass the mic to him.
Go on, Atrus.
Oh, well, Mac, you know, you've been saying this for a while now, that even back when we only had the T9, it was just a box with an engine on it, and it was nothing like the Cutter. But let me tell you, it is still the superior trade vessel, in my opinion. But no, the Panther Clipper, I think, is an amazing box. It defines everything you want in a space industrial trader, especially with the little shuttle services that you get between you and the station to unload the cargo. And then on top of that, now that they actually started packaging the ship kits together, like both the Raider and the standard one, phenomenal. Do you ever look at what a Raider Panther Clipper looks like? It's amazing the amount of skulls you can have on that thing.
It is very cool. I love the way that it's too big to get through the letterbox, and it needs the little shuttlecraft to move the cargo to and from the space station. That's obviously if you take it to an orbital. I mean, most people these days for bulk runs go straight down to the planet's surface, don't they?
And of course, the one good thing about the Panther Clipper, though, is of course you can get a free one if you go to Hutton Orbital.
Actually, I've got a serious question for you guys. Actually, it's like, yeah, I mean, we accept the Panther Clipper's great and all that, but I just don't like flying it. I mean, as you say, it is a box. My God, it steers like one, and I personally don't find the fun in that.
Shan?
Yeah, but no. Sorry, Shan, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, well, first of all, I heard a rumor that Cal is falling in love with the Clipper, and he's petitioned Frontier to give him the Cal ship skin for it. But talking about ship kits and stuff like that, I think one ship they could really do with more paint skins and a ship kit is the Merlin. I mean, the Merlin is so underrated and so much fun to fly. It does really need extra stuff.
Yeah, that's true. They keep pumping out new spoilers and paint jobs for the Constrictor, but I feel like the Merlin's been a bit over. Anyway, that's probably enough on paint jobs. So the lore snapshot. So as you guys know, there's every week in the newsletter, there is a detailed lore snapshot where the narrative team take us behind the scenes of one of the facets of the Elite Dangerous lore, which is brilliant, because, and I've always loved it, because the Elite franchise as a whole has one of the deepest and richest traditions of narrative and lore, and FDev are obviously completely aware and proud of this, and take every action they can to maximize our enjoyment of it and make the most of that tremendous asset that they have, and have reiterated several times that they will never take that for granted or not make the most of that. And the newsletter is a really good case in point, because every week obviously we get the really detailed lore snapshots. And this week's was Galcop, a history of the in-game entity Galcop. Did you guys see this? I thought it was really interesting. And I'm probably the most into lore out of everybody here, but I for one thought it was really, really brilliant and told me a few things I didn't know. Did you guys see it?
I did, yes. What I thought particularly insightful is we finally know what happened to them.
Yes, true. Yeah, good point. We won't spoil it for any listeners who haven't read the newsletter yet, but yeah, check it out. Okay, development insights. We also got a few, obviously, the cursory bits of behind the scenes concept art, and there was one that I think, Ben, were you talking about this earlier? The Alliance military uniform, or was that Atrus? It might have been Atrus.
Oh well, yeah. I don't know about you guys, but to me, it looked a little bit too much like Starfleet. You know, the red shirts. So maybe a bit concerned about what they think about the Alliance military, but I'm not going to go into that right now. But overall, though, like, I think it's a good concept art. It doesn't really quite match the grandeur that we saw with the Imperials, which obviously fits really in nicely with their, you know, with their whole backstory and whatnot. But the Federation ones, to me, kind of reminded me of the uniforms that we saw. How many of you guys played StarCraft II and remember being on the bridge of the battlecruiser and you saw everyone in the uniforms during the... you kind of reminded me of that with all the fanfare.
I love StarCraft II.
What's that, Mac?
I love StarCraft II, yes.
Absolutely. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. Like the Terran, you know, military uniforms that they had on the bridge with the all that crazy fanfare and the medals, and it kind of reminded me like of a combination of Judge Dredd and what's the other Warhammer.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Shan?
I'm actually pleased they went with the Starfleet look, because in some of the screenshots they showed in a dev, earlier dev diary, they'd gone with a Firefly, Malcolm Reynolds look, and I thought that's a bit too obvious, really. So I'm quite glad they went the way they did, because I'm not sure having people walk around as they would in Firefly is a bit kind of...
Yeah, not everybody can wear a trench coat. Yeah, I'm not super fussy about the Alliance military uniform. I'm just pleased that the Alliance is really well fleshed out as a superpower, you know. I sometimes just think, like, imagine if that wasn't the case, and how much poorer the game would be. So I'm just happy to see that that getting some love. So we also had a look back. As a couple of pages in the newsletter were a retrospective on the timeline of the overall Elite Dangerous development to date. And this was really cool because, you know, the updates are so regular, they're so well telegraphed, and they're so clearly laid out in advance in the roadmap, that it's sometimes easy to take for granted just the pace of change that we've seen with Elite. And I actually, for one, found it really useful to see it laid out sort of, you know, in bullet points, essentially. So for those of you who haven't seen, obviously, we had the 2015 brought us the planetary landings for the first time. So it gave us the ability to...
That's the Airless Worlds, wasn't it?
Airless Worlds, yeah. To land on Airless Worlds, get into the SRV, bomb around. And actually, there's quite a lot to do on the planets. And the SRV, obviously, was done really well and has been... perennially popular part of the game, even if the planets that update gave us access to were actually just airless rocks and snowballs. But anyway, it set the pace. And then obviously 2016 brought us after the Horizon series lasted exactly a year. The 2016 update was a little bit more modest. It was just volcanic planets. So 2016 obviously brought us lava worlds. And let us land on sort of Mercury likes and volcanic worlds with detailed volcanism and lava flows and all that sort of thing, which was very dramatic, very fun, and also often overlooked. It also brought us PS4 and Xbox crossplay, which people don't often talk about enough, but I feel like it has actually really improved the game.
It has.
2017. This is the big one, obviously. Who wants to touch on the Shan? Do you want to touch on the 2017 update for us?
Yeah, I think we were stunned when the screenshots of the atmospheric planets came out, and also they then combined that with the space legs as well. It looked as though they'd been working on it since before the release of the game in 2014, so it in my view they'd probably have a completely different team working on that. But it wasn't just like with atmospheric planets, it wasn't just like you go through and there's a graphic and different particle effects and stuff like that. It was fully realized atmospheres, so you can skim along just above the clouds and see the hurricane. So, you know, as you know, when you go to an Earthlight, now you see a storm system on the Earthlight, and you can go down and visit that storm system where it's actually at in game. That was just mind blowing. And then having the space legs to walk around this environment, being able to hang out and chill with your friends in the bars. Then of course you had the ship boarding mechanic and all the sort of stuff that we've got so used to. It was, yeah, unbelievable.
EVA, I particularly love. Just the ability to come out of your base on a beautiful atmospheric world, a beautiful Earth-like, climb into your ship, take off, leave the atmosphere, and then EVA out and look back at that pearlescent planet below you. Just totally mind-blowing. Really fantastic. It still gets me every time. 2018 obviously brought fleet carriers and PS4 VR support, which is brilliant. Fleet carriers obviously was
game changing. Yeah, because
yeah,
I know we'd wondered what on earth they're going to be used for, but who knew the Use Frontier came up with them would have been so good and so essential, really.
Yeah, and it's so good to see them arrive bang on the end of 2018 as well, to just round off the Beyond series exactly when planned. Atrus?
Yeah, I just want to mention with 2017, you guys forgot the fact that, you know, with our pilots in particular and walking around the ships, you didn't really mention the fact that we can actually now drink Alpha Centauri gin and Lavian brandy on board and fly our ships drunk in game. in fact, I tried to dock drunk and I ended up getting fined from the station for inappropriate flying.
Wow, what a surprise. Yeah, I feel like drinking the Lavian brandy, like drinking so you get the drunk screen effects is the kind of thing that everybody does once and then just so they can say they have, just so they can say,
and then after the read-by screen they never do it again.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I hear there's some really hardcore guys in Newton's Gambit who do all this and then go flight assist off and try to dock and do various things with FA off, and apparently some of them got really good at it, and yeah, that's a very special skill, I think.
Don't forget the onion head effect. That is still trippy as all hell when the screen goes all purple from smoking that.
Yeah. Very cool. Very, very cool. Anyway, let's move on. 2019. This was widely anticipated, and was really looked forward to by a particularly vocal contingent of the player base, and that's Gas Giant Mining. And there were always doubters about it, and people who said, like, oh, you know, what would be the utility and what would be the gameplay associated. But Gas Giants, I thought, brought a huge amount to the game, because those giant beautiful planets ceased to just be marbles in space and actually became things that you can interact with. And the flight model, particularly the how the density of the cloud layers affects the way your ship behaves, has never got old for me. I thought last year's Gas Giant update was totally brilliant. Shan?
I was a bit sad with Gas Giants, really, because you now have the ability to refuel from any Gas Giant. I don't know about you, but I kind of miss the fuel rats, because now you can refuel anywhere. The fuel rats' use just kind of dried up, really, so I was a bit sad to see them decline.
Yeah, fair enough. I mean, you see this...
On the other hand, it's been a real boon for the hull seals, because there are so many new ways of damaging your ship. I agree with you that the loss of the fuel rats was a bit too bad. And especially, I mean, to add insult to injury, they took, you know, all those fuel rat ads they had on stations, they took them out as well. I thought that was rubbing it in a little bit much. But on the other hand, the hull seals have had an absolute whale of a time with all the new and interesting repair mechanics that the Gas Giants brought, because there were so many new and unusual ways in which you could damage your ship.
Yeah, very good point. Atrus?
Yeah, to follow up with what Mac was saying about damaging your ship, but this is actually how I lost my mining T10 when I was first trying to do... So the one thing I should start with is that the science behind the Gas Giants that Frontier has implemented is phenomenal. And the metrics that you now can actually look at from the system navigation panel, where it actually shows you the information about the planet, about the wind speeds and the different layers, the pressures at different atmospheres. So with Jupiter, for example, it actually may rain diamonds on it in real life. And they decided, you know, in game, we're going to make it possible to mine diamonds from the atmosphere of certain gas giants at a certain pressure. So I lost my mining T10 because I wasn't able to actually compensate for the different storms that were going on within the planet. And it was actually a really incredible experience to just go in there in such a large ship and then suddenly lose control of it and spin out of control and lose all this cargo. But the nice thing is that because of the new persistence system that they added as well, some guy came along, collected all my diamonds after seeing me fail spectacularly, and ran off with the boon.
That's nice that the game supports that. I love that it supports that.
Although a slight whinge at the imagination of players, I'm getting a bit bored of players calling their cloud bases Bespin. Everywhere you go, it's Bespin this and Bespin that. It's kind of, think of a different name, guys. Come on.
That brings us on to the other, that's an excellent segue there, Shan. Brings us on to the other big update of last year, which was base building, obviously. I mean, for me, this has been, I didn't buy Elite because I wanted to build houses all over the galaxy. I just wanted to fly a spaceship. But I tell you what, I've absolutely loved the ability to like stake a claim on a planet and build a little base there and you know, grow crops and have a little place to call my own, a little foothold in the galaxy. It's really changed the game for me. And
one of the things I was worried about, but I'm glad Frontier are on top of it, is I was quite concerned when they said you could rename your base to whatever you wanted. So, you know, you looked on the navigation display and it'd be this base name. I'm really glad Frontier are on top of people stopping them calling them abusive names and swearing and all sorts of stuff like that. You know, I mean, I was kind of like, I was afraid of that. You'd have like, you'd go down to Lave 2 and you'd see Trump Towers or something like that would be on there. So I'm really glad they're on top of that.
Yeah. It's definitely been that for me. I think the biggest game changers have been atmospheric landings and space legs and base building. Those three have really, really dramatically changed my love of the game and made it greater. So who wants to talk about the roadmap for the rest of 2020?
Yeah, I'll jump in, but I will just say something quickly, and you can all get a drink. One of the things I was looking through that development timeline, and I was a little bit sad actually, because I remember back in 2014 when ArenaNet mentioned they'd cancelled Guild Wars 2 because they didn't actually have the resources to finish it. So, you know, I don't really know what Guild Wars 2 would have been like had they finished it, but just seeing how much Frontier actually managed to get through.
Yeah, I don't think you'd have liked it, actually.
I don't know. But anyway, in late 2020, finally we are getting access to the Andromeda Galaxy via the Raxler Stargate. And I just can't wait to go through the Raxler Stargate and visit Andromeda. I just can't wait for that. That'll be immense.
Yeah, I was a little bit dubious when they said that they were going to there were going to be ways that for players to actually, you know, to solve the riddles of where Raxler is and I was a little bit worried about, oh god, you know, it'll be another thing that somebody cracks in half an hour and then it'll be ruined for everybody. But actually the mysteries have been really, really good. The riddles have been really smart. They've taken people working together. It's been a really interesting group effort over the course of the year, which is which I've really enjoyed.
I did like how, I think it was a few weeks ago, Canon posted in the forum saying they were completely stuck and needed the community's help to decode the riddles, and everyone just kind of jumped in and helped the Canon out getting the riddles done. So I thought that was superb.
Yeah, good little show of community spirit. Cool.
I think what a lot of people are missing about the Andromeda, because earlier on in the game, people lamented that, explorers in particular, that the galaxy was effectively, it wasn't all mapped, but it was all charted, so it was easy to plot a route anywhere. But the nice thing with the new galaxy is when you jump there, absolutely nothing's plotted. So the community is going to actually have to chart their way through the stars to build up all the routes.
Oh, I can't wait for that.
And I think from the exploration point of view, that will be probably the most exciting bit of it all, is that everybody's going to have to actually chart the path through it rather than just look at the Gal map and off they go.
Yeah. And also, they said the process of using the Stargate will disable your frameshift engineering mods. So you have to have like a 2015, 2016 style jump range. And there'll be none of this kind of cruising down the M6 with 80 light year jump range, because the Stargate will affect the jump drive.
Yeah, back to Anacondas with only 40 light year jump range.
Indeed. Right, we've got quite a lot we've got quite a few main discussions. There's been a few things, a few bits and bobs of controversy on the forums that I want to touch on. which are our main discussion for this evening. So we're going to do have a quick advert break and then come back for that. So if you're listening, do stay tuned.
Lave Radio, it's even louder than me. Hey, wait a minute, that can't be right.
This is a public service announcement from the Fuel Rats. Please stop what you're doing and pay attention. If we can rescue you, we will, but you can help us help you by following these easy steps. 1. Fly 50 light seconds or so from the system's main star and drop out of supercruise. 2. Note down the current system and the nearest stellar body. 3. If you're on emergency life support, log out immediately. 4. Go to fuelrats.org and click Get Help. 5. Stay calm, hold your breath, and let our seasoned professionals do what they do best. The Fuel Rats. We have fuel, you don't. Any questions?
And we're back. We're now on our main discussion. We've got quite a few topics, really. We've had to cut them down a bit, because otherwise we'd go on, really. We touched on this earlier, though. The Moray Starboat, there's been quite a lot of discussion saying, is it really worth it for underwater exploration? Or are you better off actually using the scuba diving mechanic? You know, is it more immersive, if you pardon the pun, experience? Scuba diving using the Moray. So what do you guys think?
Well, for me personally, when they first introduced the underwater exploration, I was using an Orca and I really quite liked it. And I haven't had really too much time to spend in the Moray Starboat, but from what it looks like and everything that I've been reading about it, it sounds like it's even better than the Orca in terms of underwater handling. And also the viewports on it are amazing. But again, I need to kind of figure out as well whether it's worth the scuba diving or not. I'm going to be honest. I don't mess around too much with the water worlds. I just don't find them personally interesting. I like my earth worlds, my volcanic worlds, but water worlds, nah, not for me.
Well, one of my real highlights in the Starboat, you remember the scenes from Interstellar when the gravitational pull of the black hole creates a huge tidal wave that one. I was on a planet with pretty close to a neutron star, and that actually happened. They'd modeled this huge tidal wave coming at me in the Moray Starboat, and if I'd been scuba diving, I'd have been gone. But because I was in the Moray and I had shields and stuff like that, it bounced me around a little bit, but I survived in it. So, yeah, I think you need to be careful when you're scuba diving. It's substantially riskier.
Definitely has use cases. Ben?
Yeah, I'm just going to say, I like the Moray, and I like that we've got the underwater vehicles for it as well. So, you know, you've got your ship launch fighters, you've got your ship... It feels very much like Thunderbird 4 when it goes off and drops into the sea.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
That transition effect and the visibility, the maneuverability of the ship I just love. Yes, okay, you can get more up close and personal if you're in your scuba gear. I'm hoping we're going to get hard suits at some point, actually, because the things I'd like to see in the deep sea trenches, obviously the scuba gear is not good for. But
and obviously the game models the pressure and stuff. So
yeah, I mean you can see it in your starboard, but I'd like to actually get up close and personal with some of the tubers and things like that.
Yeah, I hear that. I mean, from my point of view, I just love caves, which you can't experience them properly from the moray. I like being able to actually, you know, do spelunking underwater and see the cool procedural life and the weird squid monsters flitting about and all that kind of thing. And I just don't feel you get the. I hear what Shan's saying. There is like a durability aspect to being in the ship underwater, but
Have you been chased by a leviathan yet?
Not yet.
Oh, well, you're seen in The Phantom Menace, you know, when they're in the little boat and they're running along and all these sea monsters are coming
out. Yes.
That's just brilliant. You get, you know, you get this little fish coming at you and all of a sudden the leviathan comes out and does the episode one thing. It's superb.
Very cool. Very, very cool. Okay, well, let's move on from underwater. We'll have to do a special. We'll have to do a dedicated episode on underwater exploration. CQC, are the bots too good for players? I keep hearing this on the forum and elsewhere. People saying that the bots are overpowered and CQC is, you know, super easy to find a match, but the NPCs are a little bit too powerful. Who here regularly plays CQC?
I hear this accusation being made all the time. The thing is I think they're quite well matched. If you
get good,
practice
right?
A little bit, I mean, you can't just sit there. You can't just expect to just fly around CQC with FA on and all that kind of stuff. You got to manage your pips. You got to at least use FA off to turn around and that kind of thing. So you got to practice. If they made it too easy, the skill ceiling would be too low, and what would be the point? So, I think people are just going to whine. People are just whining.
Yeah, I'm inclined to agree. I mean, I know everybody here. I know everybody in the Lave Radio crew, used to be a bit dismissive of CQC, but since FDev have put so much work into it over the years and had so many balance passes on it, you've got to admit that it does work brilliantly now. And yes. I know that everybody here plays it quite a lot.
I just love watching it.
Yeah, it is a great spectator sport.
It's so much fun to watch this. Yeah, and getting those the camera drones and just zipping along or auto following your ships and things. Yeah, you know, it's just so watchable. I can't really say anything more than that. It's just
the other good thing they added to it was the auto tournament mode, a bit like StarCraft 2 has the auto tournament, so you can just anyway, I'll pass the mic over to Shan. I butted in there a bit.
No, it was fine. You can really tell Sarah Jane Avery has put her heart and soul into bots. And do you remember about a couple of months ago, just before they had the patch, is what they did, they invited a few of the top PvP players. And they adapted the way these bots flew based on the input and basically recorded how these PvP players fought and made the bots mimic it. So maybe that's why people found that a bit hard, because they're modeled on real people.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I think this person's name is Kirov099. Sorry if I've got that wrong. Says, I'm really upset that they gave the CQC bots engineered modules. It was a terrible decision. So I think that, you know, that could be part of why people find them difficult. That they're exhibiting sort of unusual behaviours and they're flying with engineered modules.
They should just get good.
I agree. They should just get good. I think this kind of speaks of a wider trend that's definitely been in evidence in Elite Dangerous over the last 18 months. It's something that I've noticed. I'd be interested to hear what you guys think. And that is that PvP is just getting so much attention from the devs. I feel like every Frontier live stream, it's, oh, you know, the this week's PvP league and you know, the the Icarus Cup. You know, with the third bloody Icarus Cup now. I feel like all we read about is the damn Icarus Cup. And I don't know. I just feel like PvP is getting a huge amount of focus from.
Well, I think it really took off when they made it balanced, and you know, it wasn't so much about how many people you could gank you and things like that. But they sorted the crime and punishment system out, and they made it more balanced. So it became a much more of a skill activity than a let's gang up and gank someone. And I thought that I think it just really helped the crime and punishment, and that I think was the key.
Yeah, I think I totally agree with that. I think the getting crime and punishment so right, so that high security systems really feel very secure, and low security feel much less safe. It's the fact that when you're in a high security, you can expect to be safe, and when you're in a low security, you know that you're at risk. I feel like they nailed that, and PvP really did start to work as a game mechanic when they got the crime and punishment system right. Anyway, we'll talk about CQC another time. Somebody complained that since I think it was one of the 2016 quarter patches, the SRV variants patch. I don't know if you guys remember this, but it was a whole quarter where the patch was just SRV variants. So that brought us the hover bikes, the speeders, the tanks, the walkers, you know, the ones that like look like mechs, and a couple of others. And a few people I know have said, "Oh God, there are so many bloody SRV variants. They all, you know, I don't know what's what. It's so confusing." And obviously a few other people commented that actually no, they're really necessary, and imagine what the game would be like if we only had one. And that's really what it comes down to for me. I just feel like they add so much life to the game.
They do. My favorite one is, you know, the one that looks like Optimus Prime.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. The walker.
And it can transform into a ship-launched fighter. Oh, that's right. That's Decepticons, aren't they? It's like a Decepticon. Where it transforms into a ship launched fighter, and it can then land, and then it becomes an SRV. That's my favourite, the Transformer one.
I think that one didn't come in the SRV variant. That one came in the update where they made multiple.
I think you're right. Yeah, you're right.
And wings work together perfectly.
Yeah, I was going to say multi-crew SRVs were probably the best. I mean, the variants are nice and all that, but getting it to work with multi-crew was probably the turning point.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, some people have said like, "Oh, you know, why didn't they work perfectly?" And that seems a little bit churlish to me. I mean, you can't get everything right first time. But the fact that Frontier saw that multi-crew and wings not working together was stupid and went back and quite quickly fixed it was really cool. Atrus.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention that also with those SRVs that came out, especially when they built the surface miner SRV, the one that does the laser mining right into the planet. Not yeah. like the old Prospector one. I think a lot of people thought at that point, that's when we knew base building was in the pipeline.
Yeah.
I think that was because everyone was like, why would we have, you know, the ability to set up these surface miners unless we were able to come back to them?
Yeah.
Have you tried to land one on an asteroid yet?
Yeah, it hasn't gone too well. So I don't know if you guys happen to notice that occasionally in one of the rings, like, it depends on which systems you go to, but every now and then you see something kind of flying in the distance and it resembles a space loach. So, you know.
I think that's part of the onion head effect.
I don't think
space loaches exist. I'm pretty sure, yeah.
Yeah, so I've been wondering about this myself personally, because a few times I've gone now, I've just seen that out in the distance and I'm like, right, this is probably not a good idea. This is going to end horribly for me.
Ben. Atrus, you were saying about the asteroid mining. I mean, I know I went off and tried that the other week, and it felt almost like I was playing billiards, essentially. Like, yeah, I'm taking the module in carefully, and I'm going in as slow as I can, and then I kiss the bloody asteroid, and then, of course, the asteroid buggers off without me.
That's Newtonian physics, mate.
How the hell are you meant to do it? There's no net that I can shove round the asteroid. Like, I can't go and put thrusters on the other side of the asteroid. You know, I'm coming in at 1 meter a second, and is like, no, just grab the bastard. And it's
all about a gentle touch. Gentle, gentle, gentle touch.
Ben doesn't do gentle.
Oh, no, I might sound like it rough. I might like sleeve rough. Thrusting down.
Right, before we get too derailed, Tuplex in chat says, similar to the Space Loach comment earlier, he says, I heard the Thargoid Scouts will be available in CQC anytime soon. I mean, what a rumour. Has anybody heard that?
To be honest, I just hope they go off and add the Guardians in too.
Yeah, good point. Yeah. Oh, the Guardian fighters.
Yeah.
I think they did. Oh,
no, I want the Guardian Guardians.
Oh yeah, the proper Guardian. Yeah.
Not the human Guardian hybrid monstrosity.
Yeah, I mean, they've been in CQC for years.
I saw the rumor for the Guardian and the Thargoid ships in CQC, but I'm not sure because it said. You had to earn them, and you couldn't just use arcs. Because with other ships, you just use arcs, don't you? And you can have them. So, but these you have to earn, so I'm not sure if that's right.
Tuplex also says, and we can finally join more than one squadron, huzzah! So clearly Tuplex has not been around for a couple of years, because you've been able to join more than one squadron since late 2018, when they were first introduced.
Yeah, Frontier read the feedback.
Yeah, exactly. It was only in the beta when you could only join one, and then they quickly changed it when everybody said that was a terrible idea. So Tuplex has obviously been away. But anyway, let's move on. So we've got I want to talk a little bit about player economy now. So obviously Elite has a really, really in-depth and totally player-driven economy. There's a couple of things recently that are salient to this that have come up that we ought to touch on. So first of all, Mac, the Trading Post, which is a trading exchange run by the East India Company, has been doing super well. Do you want to just talk us through that?
Yeah, what they've done is quite interesting, and. I guess it's a relatively straightforward system, but what they've done is you as a if you're a rich enough player faction as we are, you can actually now set up a stock market, which we've done, and it kind of works like a real commodities market. So instead of having to do the tiresome thing of coming out with sort of having to buy whale accounts and have these things you store in space stations full of materials and full of goods we're going to trade and material. Actually, I'll get to materials in a second. And then having to swap it for, I don't know, imperial slaves or something like that. We've now actually got a proper stock exchange, which we've set up in Lundball City in LTT 1349. We did think about putting it in Kappa for Onassis, but we decided to put it in LTT in the end. And you can actually speculate on it as well. So you can do all the normal kind of, you can trade futures and you can do just normal kind of commodities market things. You can do a market order or you can do a limit order like you would do on a stock market. And so and basically what we do is we feed this market and we try and tend to it, and maybe there's a little bit of manipulation that goes on from time to time, and we make an absolute shed load of money off it, making us even more fabulously rich than we were before. But although the system's quite simple, it's resulting in some quite complex behaviors. We also have a materials trade. Now, if you remember the old materials trader where you just trade one material from the other and each station's only got one type, this one actually does it with all the materials and data, manufactured, the raw and the data. And it works with credits and it works with supply and demand. And it's something we've managed to set up and expand through a lot of BGS work. And it's been absolutely brilliant. I think Wolf 409, whatever they're called, the Alliance lot, I think they've managed to get up a stock market as well. But to our knowledge, we're the we were probably the first to get ours up because, well, that's what we do. But yeah, it's added, I think, a lot of depth to the game, and it brings a lot of players into our systems, which there's other emergent game play this brings, because of course we now need to have some security escort. So that brings in the PvP part of it, because there are players who want to try and upset our markets and blockade our system. So we have to deal with that with our PvP wing, which has had to put in a lot of practice recently. But it really has added. It's a relatively simple change that's added an awful lot to it.
And how
yeah,
has it?
It's brilliant.
Sorry, didn't mean to interrupt. How has the trading post been affected by gas giant mining? Because people have said that the problem with gas giant mining is that it unbalances the economy too much, because so many people are rushing to do it. And I guess my response is well, you know, because the economy is completely player driven, the more players do something, the lower the price gets, and therefore it's self-correcting.
Exactly that. It's supply and demand, and us as the market makers, we get to skim off the top anyway. So who cares if people are trading? We get rich.
Yeah, exactly. Ben, you had a question for Mac.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, actually, what do you guys make of the stuff that's being taken into consideration by Frontier for the anti-gold farming ideas? And just defeating the botters and so on.
Yeah, it's always a tricky question, and we were wondering, because you're always going to get the one thing you probably can never stop: the people who actually load up the game client and play it for pay. That's a difficult nut to crack, but they've got various.
Yeah, so you got the factories in China of basically. Yeah.
But they've got some anti-cheat. They look for, I believe, of course, they can't tell us what they're doing, because then that would reveal to the bad actors what to do to get around it. But they certainly have a system of behavioral pattern matching. So I did actually accidentally run across a forum where they always call them trainers. I don't know why they call them trainers. They're cheats. I mean, let's not beat about the bush here. Because of client side software hacks and whatever. And there was so many people on this forum whinging about being banned that obviously whatever they're doing is working. Whatever detection they've got is working, because people are actually getting banned left, right, and center for trying to.
Well, that's right. Because skipping ahead. Will announced last week they banned 2,623 players for exploiting cheating and toxic behavior. So that completely ties in what you said. I mean, the numbers are a bit down on what was the week before, but still 2,600 players being banned for those is good going.
Yeah. I what I really liked is the communication that went with that. Just simply, you know, we run the game. We have the tools. It is very obvious to us when players are cheating. We just ban them, and we are and it's uncomplicated, and the health of the game comes first, which I thought was a really, really lovely attitude and really good.
And also, the little ban hammer animation was a great touch, I think.
Indeed. We've had a couple of comments from people, from listeners. Bograt says, has anybody tried the SRV road train yet? The 200-ton cargo capacity SRV with turrets on every trailer. That is a very, very cool variant, Bograt.
Have you tried that with multi-crew, actually?
Not yet, no.
You get a bunch of your mates in that thing and go off and, you know, put Smokey and the Bandit on or something like that. It's so much fun.
I did see, I think it was on one of the planets in the Shinrata system. You know the scene in Solo where they're trying to rob train?
Yeah.
I did see something like that from the Solo film. It was brilliant.
The trouble with that thing is it runs out of ammo too quickly. I don't know if any of you lot have played Factorio, but you can make that train car with a huge cannon on it. It's kind of reminiscent of that, but and just like that, it also needs a ton of ammo mined from a ton of materials, which takes ages, and then you run out in like 5 seconds flat. I mean, it's spectacular when it's going, but anyway.
Yeah. Prime Bitstorm says the Guardian CQC fighter can only be unlocked by getting a special exploration mission, the Ancient Fighter, which is found in a cavern deep under an ice world. Thanks, Prime Bitstorm. That is super useful to know, and I hadn't done that mission yet. Thank you for that. Kaizen says that his favorite part of the game is now T-Rex hunting in his Cobra. Well, whose isn't, Kaizen? Whose isn't? And Tuplex says that he likes that all the combat logs are being cast into CQC now. I enjoyed that. It's good fun. The last thing I want to touch on before we get on to Community Corner is the Racing League.
Hang on, Sue, this is the bottom one, I think, probably needs more discussion.
Okay. Yeah, okay. So the Racing League has been a huge success since Frontier added checkpoints and race markers into the game in a small patch a couple of years ago now. The racing has really, really taken off in the game, and it's really nice to see it so well organized and well recognized. And I know people have said, like, oh God, you know, it's super easy, don't give them that much praise. It was just literally lifting the checkpoints out of the tutorial and sticking them in the main game. But you know, sometimes the low-hanging fruit is worth picking. Sometimes it's worth doing this stuff. And hats off to Frontier. They saw that it would win. They saw that it would really improve the game, and they just went and did it. And racing is phenomenal. I don't know about you guys, but I've absolutely loved racing around the tracks that people like Alec Turner have been setting up on the planets, and whizzing through the checkpoints and deploying the race markers and all that sort of thing. So we won't dwell on that too much, but it was worth mentioning that the Racing League is in fine health, and if you're interested in high octane pursuits, you should check it out. Moving on quickly, the what we had penciled in for our main discussion, which we'll talk about for a few minutes, is and this is a bit of a weird one, a bit of a speculative episode, I suppose, but unusual. What would Elite be like if we hadn't had all of those fantastic updates that we've talked about? If we hadn't had Elite Feet in 2017, if we hadn't had Atmospheric, if you know, for example, God forbid, if the dev diaries stopped for any reason, you know, what would the game be like now? So I want to quickly, before we go to a community corner, I want to quickly go around the table and just get people's thoughts on what that would be like. Shan, you start.
It would be really hard to maintain the interest of the players, I think, because every time they announced a new season or a new update, there'd be part of you that would hope it would be Atmospheric Landings or Elite Feet or whatever it was, and then every time that hope would be dashed, or even worse, if they didn't actually tell anyone anything at all. And they kind of treated us as children who can't tell the difference between when they say something and stuff being delayed for whatever reason. So, yeah, I think it would be soul-destroying for quite a lot of players if that communication and those updates didn't happen. It would be, I don't know, it wouldn't feel like the game had moved on at all, I don't think.
Oof, yeah, true. It would feel like the game hadn't moved on at all. It would feel that all we'd had is slightly rearranging the furniture since 2015, actually. Ben, what do you think?
I'm currently being attacked, but yeah, I'm totally with you guys. There would be nothing to do. I'd be looking into other games. I'd be playing Red Dead Redemption. I'd be playing GTA. Yeah, I don't even know if I'd be playing Elite anymore, to be honest.
Mac?
I think I'd probably end up playing a lot of StarCraft 2, to be honest. But yeah, I don't know. I can never. I've been following Elite for a long, long time, and back in the day, you know, even in Frontier First Encounters day, we were keeping the flame alive. So I don't know. I think I would probably because I mean they had VR from the get go. I think I'd have to at least a couple of times a week strap on my Rift and just fly around, do some stuff, because you know it is, after all, one of those, it's it, whatever, what it come what may, even when it even just after, say, Horizons launched, it was still pretty fun to play, especially in the Rift. But yeah, I think I'd have been playing an awful lot more StarCraft 2 and an awful lot more Train Simulator. Sorry, I'm a nerd.
Atrus?
Yeah, I'm not going to go with what Shan said. It would be a little bit soul-crushing if we lost a lot of this. In particular for me, like, I wasn't a huge fan. I wasn't there from the start of the game with the alpha. I came in right when Volcanic Planets and the crossplay was brought in. So when they announced Atmospheric Planets as a whole and then put it in Space Legs and things like that, I wasn't too keen on Space Legs, if I was honest, but it's grown on me since. And now that I've seen how they've implemented it, I would be really upset if we didn't have that gameplay, because doing EVAs, being able to run around the ship, our ships, as well as on the stations to collect missions and actually talk to interesting NPCs and things like that, I think would actually take away from the scope of the game that we've had. And then on top of that, the communications from the dev, I've never seen a game like it before. So if we lost it, it would just really kind of put us back into that stone age of where game developers never told us anything. And it's kind of a shame.
Yeah. I hear you. Shan?
Yeah, I was about to say, the other thing I think it would be disappointing if they hadn't done that is, because I don't know about you, I remember back when they said that when Horizons released, it was a new season of Elite Dangerous, and it kind of gave the impression that you were going to get a new season every year, and that's what we've got. But I just think, can you imagine thinking that every year you'd get a whole new game-changing thing and it just not turn up? It would just be like the never-ending single season. So I'm just really glad Frontier put the time and the effort and all their expertise, really, into delivering content year on year.
Yeah. I had a nightmare the other day that in my dream that I was reading the Kickstarter page and watching the dev videos from 2013 and 2014, and watching David Braben say, "Come and join us. You're going to be able to stow away on other people's ships and chase dinosaurs around, and we're building the game from the ground up with these things in mind, and you will be able to explore planets, and you will be able to explore your ships on foot." And I remember thinking, yes, take my money. And I remember paying money and as I did in real life, obviously, and being really excited for that. And then obviously in 2015, when Horizons came out, I remember I was super excited for that. But then in my dream, the next year they had the Frontier Expo, and then four of the devs sat on stage and said, this sounds super weird, but they it's a dream, I can't account for it. They said this season will be focused on core features, and then they sat there and beamed at the audience in my dream as if it was good news. And that's when my dreams turned bad. And then in the dream, every year they would say, they would make an announcement as to what the updates are going to be for that year. And rather than getting back to the roadmap promised in 2013 and 2014, each update got less and less ambitious. And it was really bad. And then I woke up and we've had cracking development. We've had really detailed roadmaps. We've had a really, really clear communication from Frontier that they are committed to what they set out to do in the Kickstarter.
I worked out the other day of how much it would have cost me if I hadn't had the lifetime pass. And it was something like £365.25.
Wow.
It would have cost me in buying the games.
That lifetime expansion pass was the best thing I bought.
Do you think they should bring it back?
I don't know. It's difficult whether. I mean, it's not a new game. It's 6 years now. Like, you know, we've had 6 years of fantastic development. It's difficult to know where what they'll do from here. Anyway, that's potentially a discussion today. If nobody has anything else to add on that, we ought to quickly talk to run through the community corner. There's several things that have been going on last week. Before we do that, sorry. Commander Miggles in game says, with such a growing player base, wouldn't we be getting hardware manufacturers making controllers specific to ED? Wasn't there one of these?
Is, I'm using it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, Miggles, whatever universe we correspond from, I'm pretty sure there is actually a controller specific to ED. It's the T1600 from Thrustmaster, isn't it?
Yes.
It is indeed, and it is a beautiful thing as well.
Anyway, so Community Corner. So in this week's live stream, we had David Braben and Sandro Simarco shaved off their beards for special effect. Did you guys catch this?
I did, yes. They're quite smart, weren't they?
They don't look anywhere near as evil as they used to.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've got so used to David Braben's hirsute lumberjack beard since 2017 that seeing him fresh baby-faced again was super weird. It was really disorientating, actually.
It didn't really take long for Will to shave his off. I mean, I know he's been working on it for a good couple of years, but... I'm sorry, mate, but...
Yeah, a bit
of wet soap would have got off and fixed that body.
But have you noticed? Have you noticed how David and Sandro's behaviour has changed since they shaved the beard off? It's like they're two different people. Have you noticed that?
What, from each other?
No, it's like someone took the bearded David Braben, took him away, and replaced him with the unbearded, kind of geekier David Braben.
He looks less homeless now.
He does look less homeless, that's true. He definitely looks less homeless. But I really enjoyed that live stream. I like the fact that we got a bit of out-of-game stuff, and then we got to see that awesome hover bike race between Will and Steven across the volcanic world. I think Will had been doing quite a lot of engineering to his, so his was a bit faster. But seeing them jet around those canyons and over those lava flows was super fun. Really, really interesting.
If only they had some sort of laser sword in game, then they could have done the Anakin Obi-Wan fight, couldn't they?
Have you been rewatching the prequels?
I'm trying to remember when Star Wars was good. You see, that's what it was.
And your first thought is the prequels.
I'm comparing anyway. Yeah, so I thought it was great fun, personally.
Yeah, it was. Distant Dinosaurs got off to a great start, and the expedition catalogued 342 new species of procedurally generated life on the stunning new planets that they've discovered. This was highlighted in the page 64 of the Frontier newsletter this week. And obviously there are several thousand participants, and it looks really, really, really good fun. And it's so cool that those guys have so many different avenues of gameplay that they can utilize for their expeditions now. Then there was the Save the Hutton Truckers. Right, who's gonna talk us through this?
Yeah, this was something that came up, I noticed, is basically, you know how Hutton Orbital used to be a 90-minute trip to the Hutton Orbital outpost from the jump-in point? Well, now they have intra-system jump points. You can just jump directly to Hutton Orbital and miss the 90-minute trip out of it. So the Hutton Truckers are worried that Hutton Orbital would just become just another Coriolis station that the specialness will go. And so they're appealing to Frontier to remove the free Anaconda. And in doing so, that will reduce the panic buying of Hutton mugs so that when the intersystem jumps come in, there's still a specialness about it. Because as I say, it used to be a 90-minute trip, and now it's just hit the jump gate and you're there. So, yeah, I think the Hutton Truckers are a bit worried, really, about it.
Yeah. It would be sad to see it become just another Coriolis, seeing as it is not a Coriolis in the first place.
They were talking about making it Coriolis. That's the point.
To better house all of those mugs, no doubt.
Well, that's right. Yeah.
And also as a place to land your free anaconda once you pick it up.
Hmm. Indeed. Right. We are nearly out of time for inhabiting this universe, and we will have to depart in a few minutes. So before we do so, is there anything more from the 80-page Frontier newsletter, the 3-hour weekly Frontier live stream, the rich and detailed roadmap of 2020 updates that anybody here would like to discuss?
Apparently, the sugar bus of Shap Sugar Bus returned.
Yeah, yes, yes, this is literally the best thing that's happened. This is the most exciting thing that's happened to Elite Dangerous this year, has been the return of Sugar Bus of Shap Sugar Bus. My favorite videos. Right, okay, well, in that case, we are going to hop through our intrasystem jump point, and we are going to travel to a much more sober dimension. In it, we have a serious Lavecon COVID-19 update. Shan, can you read this out for us?
Yes, this is from the Lavecon organizers, and this is the status as of this week. The status next week may well change, but this is where we are at the moment with Lavecon. And the statement reads, "As you all know, this is a rapidly changing situation, and it's difficult to know what we will be facing in July. With regards to Lavecon 2020, as it stands, we are continuing to plan as if the event will go ahead. But we are in dialogue with hotel staff and Frontier Development, discussing options if this becomes unviable. Our first concern is the health of our attendees, volunteers, and the organising team. We do have a secondary concern, the financial implications if the event were not to go ahead. If we go ahead with the current dates, then our policies allow attendees to ask for a refund minus the booking fee up to a month before the event. After that period, we will ask people to discuss this with us and we will do our best to help. If we have to postpone, we will offer a full refund for anyone who wants one, probably for a limited period so we know numbers. If we have to cancel the event, we will offer a full refund. Some countries have restricted gatherings and events to 500 people or less. If this became a policy in the UK, then in theory, this would not affect us, as our attendee numbers are below this threshold. However, as previously stated, our first priority is the health of all those who would be attending the event. We will update this statement as the situation changes. Thanks, Karen and the team."
There we go. So, so no change, no change at the moment, and
no. Keep an eye on the Lavecon Facebook page, because that's where the updates will be posted.
Yeah, absolutely. The Elite Community Meet has been postponed because that was due to take place quite a lot sooner. Who was due to go to this?
I was. Little bit disappointed, but to be honest, I completely understand it. It's going to be in 3 weeks' time anyway, and it would have been my first ECM, but I've got quite elderly parents and things, and it's completely the right decision to postpone it.
Yeah, so totally.
So yeah, it's a shame, but I think people have bigger concerns at the moment, so yeah.
I mean, I was supposed to attend as well, and I was looking forward to flying over and seeing everybody again, but yeah, as Shan said, it's just unfortunate with the situation at the moment, and the fact that, again, you know, I have elderly in-laws and my own parents as well, so, you know, we have to worry about our families more importantly than being able to, unfortunately, attend gaming events, but, you know, priorities are what they are.
Indeed. We have had a lot of answers to our question from last week, which was, if you could write one story for Galnet, what would the headline be? And we've actually had so many that I would suggest we're going to need to do these in next week's show. If you didn't listen last week, we asked the community, if you could write one story for Galnet, what would it be? And We had many, many, many responses. Wow. Okay, like 30. And they're some of them really excellent. So so next week we will go through them because some of them are smart, some of them are funny, some of them are stupid, but the stupid ones are also funny. So that's good. So tune in next Tuesday for that. Shan?
We just want to wish Will's roommate to get well soon. Apparently Will's roommate has fallen ill with the COVID-19, which means Will is also stuck with his roommate for the next 2 weeks. So we just wish them well, really, and the same as with anyone, really. And just a serious sort of personal note is we keep hearing about how COVID is the invisible enemy. Well, the invisible enemy is fear. It just robs people of everything, of action, of everything. So be careful, but don't be fearful, is what my lesson is for the day.
And a little bit of news from me. Been watching our Twitter feed and all the other bits of social media that Sagittarius Eye has a presence on, then you won't know, but Sagittarius Eye is releasing issue 27. No, sorry, issue 26. Is it 26? I've got no idea. An issue. We're releasing an issue on Thursday this week. So it is our quarter one 3306 issue. We cover a bunch of really exciting stuff, including Newton's Gambit, a player group who dedicate their entire activity in game to fight assist off. They literally don't turn it on. We cover the upcoming lore tour. We have a we have an obituary of a well-known fictional figure. We have a couple of expeditions and recaps of their itineraries and what they're all about. Lots of other exciting player-driven news. So make sure to check out the Sagittarius Eye website on Thursday, which is www.sagittarius-eye.com.
Issue 26.
Issue 26. Perfect. Yep. So shout-outs. Our sister station, Hunt Orbital Radio, broadcasts on Thursdays from 8:30. You can tune in at tv.forthemug.com or just for the audio at radio.forthemug.com. The Discerning Commander, who likes a bit of CQC action, can avail themselves of all the fantastic new matchmaking we were discussing earlier by going to the CQC Discord at discord.me/EliteDangerousCQC. Thank you very much to those who have been chipping in on Twitch chat and in-game. It's been super, super fun, and we've had loads of really hilarious comments, and I'm sorry that I haven't been able to read all of them out. I've tried to, but the show has clipped along at a pace, and I haven't been able to get around them all. But it's been really, really, really fun having you all chipping in. But that is it for this episode of Lave Radio. If you would like to get in touch with the show, then you can email info@laveradio.com. You can hit us up on facebook.com/laveradio. You can tweet us on @laveradio, or you can join our Discord server by going to discord.io/laveradio. We also have a TeamSpeak server where commanders come to hang out and chat, which you can find at teamspeak.laveradio.com. Do get in touch if you have any questions or if there's anything you'd like us to discuss in a future episode. Lave Radio is recorded live on a Tuesday evening at 8:30 and streamed out on laveradio.com/live. Thank you to Commander Shan. Thank you to Commander Edelweiss. Thank you to Atrus. And thank you to Mac Winston. And special thanks to today's tech specialist, Commander Ventura. Until next time, Commanders, fly safe. And if you can't do that, fly dangerous.
Ja, wie war das mit Assist? Hochklopp, der Joel. Schema ist da.
position of the map.
Alternate Universe, Galnet News Digest, 17th of March, 3306. We read the news from an alternate reality, so you don't have to. In a packed bulletin tonight, Petraeus flees as Federal forces invade. Thargoid negotiations intensify. Daring Pirate Raid targets Prince Jordan. Raxler Wormhole, research continues. Buckyballers celebrate Olympus Pentathlon. Petraeus flees as Federal forces invade. Senator Denton Petraeus, Admiral of the Imperial Fleet, has been forced to flee his home in Eotienses after the system came under intense bombardment from a combined Federal task force. The raid was organised on the direct orders of President Hudson and is widely interpreted as a counter-offensive to divert Imperial forces from their so-called liberation of Tol Ceti from the Federation. According to reports, 7 Farragut-class battlecruisers jumped out of hyperspace near Eotienses A3, catching the 2 Imperial interdictors of the Petraeus home fleet off guard and rendering them inoperable within minutes. The Federal battle fleet then undertook a series of suborbital bombing runs, apparently targeting an area close to the senatorial residence. These bombing runs continued for around half an hour, until rescue arrived in the form of a flotilla of fleet carriers believed to have been under instruction from Emperor Lavinie Duval herself. The Federal fleet is not believed to have suffered any casualties, but was forced to retreat under onslaught from vessels piloted by commanders from a number of factions, including Lavinie's Legion. Admiral Petraeus is said to have escaped in an Imperial courier that he piloted himself. He is believed to have later returned to the system. It's not yet clear how much damage has been caused to the official residence, but there are concerns that ground troops from the Earth Defence Fleet may still be on the planet, and may attempt to assassinate the President. Emperor Lavinie Duval has made it clear that the Empire will not be diverted from its strategic work to prevent the Federation from developing artificial intelligence weaponry any further. Thargoid negotiations intensify. Tharg the Mighty has given humanity an ultimatum. Leave the Pleiades or be crushed. It comes following the total destruction of Obsidian Orbital and Titan's Daughter by a Thargoid mothership. But it's not completely clear at this stage whether the Thargoid negotiating position might be intended simply to gain concessions. The Thargoids have been demanding the handover of Engineer Laurie Jameson as an act of retribution for the crimes committed by her great-grandfather, Commander John Jameson. It appears that the Thargoid interest in the Pleiades is restricted to systems containing the Barnacle mining devices. But the rate of production of new Thargoid ships at the hatcheries in the region seems to be intensifying, so a full-blown confrontation cannot be ruled out. The ongoing conflict between Empire and Federation is complicating the negotiations, with Jasmina Halsey of the Alliance conducting most of the proceedings on behalf of humanity. She travels to the negotiating sessions using her Moray starboat, which has been specially kitted out to land in the Ammonia Lakes off the Thargoid homeworld. Daring Pirate Raid targets Prince Jordan. The Code has pulled off their most daring raid yet, in the Mintaka system. Having intercepted an encrypted communication from the Semies system, they correctly guessed that there was something or someone of interest on board the converted Panther Clipper gas dredger Argonautica. Intercepting the dredger as it was making a pass through the upper atmosphere of the gas giant, and using the stealth for which they're rightly famed, they managed to gain access using an unsecured airlock, quickly overpowered the crew in hand-to-hand combat, and in the process identified their prize, none other than Prince Jordan Rochester, husband to Princess Aisling Duval, and a growing force in the mining business. The Code has demanded payment of 12 billion credits in return for the safe return of Rochester. Raxler Wormhole, research continues. Canon Interstellar believes that it may be within weeks of solving the puzzle of Raxler. Following the startling discovery late last year that the long-sought-after secret of the Dark Wheel was in an unmarked system between Lave and Deeso, commanders have been attempting to work out how to activate the mechanism. Canon believes that it has partially decrypted the inscription, and that the other end of the jump gate is likely to be in or near the Messier 31 galaxy, in other words, the Andromeda galaxy. Quite what we'll find when we get there is a complete mystery. Will we find the rumoured Dark Wheel colony? Will we find alien cultures? Will the first ship through be ambushed as it arrives at its destination? When it happens, and whatever the outcome, this will be the most momentous event since the invention of the frameshift drive. Buckyballers celebrate Olympus Pentathlon. Following on from the success of the Sea of Tranquility racing event, the federal capital of Olympus City on Mars played host this week to the Buckyball Racing Club, who were hosting their first ever pentathlon. Combining the disciplines of running, scuba diving, big game hunting, flying a light assault truck, and fencing with lightsabers, the event is considered to be the most grueling so far for a generation of commanders more used to sitting in their cockpit. 30 competitors took part, much to the consternation of residents. As usual, Commander Alec Turner came a creditable second, with ultra-competitive Commander Will Flanagan of the Pilots Federation snatching first place. The marked race course near Olympus Village is one of a number of recently installed facilities which both the Buckyballers and the elite racers plan to put to good use in the coming months. Next month's race will be at the course through the Teon Isla Orbital Graveyard. And that was this week's Alternate Reality Galnet News. There's far too much going on to cram into a single bulletin, so don't forget you can catch up on all the latest happenings delivered direct to your cockpit with the 24-hour rolling Galnet audio feed. Galnet News, we inhabited an alternate reality so we could all dream for a bit.
Never forget what the spoon is a smug git.
That goes.